The India-Africa Business Network was launched this week as a response to the demand for a deeper engagement between African and Indian business sector. Abdullah Virache, who is director of the India-Africa Business Network, Shambhu Kumaran, the Deputy High Commissioner of India, and Mahendran Murli, CEO of First Rand India, join us in studio now to tell us how the new work network will change the business landscape between the two countries. Welcome to you all. Thanks so much for joining us. Abdullah, let's start off with you because, you know, at the top, we need to unpack the value proposition behind an enhanced India-South Africa business relationship and South-South cooperation in this respect specifically.
Sure. Good morning, Anisha. I think firstly, a few factors. The one is in December 2010, South Africa was invited to be part of the BRIC economies. And a lot of analysis around that was, is South Africa deserved to be a member of the BRIC countries? I think this is in a response to that. South Africa has been invited to the BRIC economies. How do we take advantage of that invitation to be part of the BRIC countries? The relationship between South Africa and India is deep. It's entrenched. It goes back a number of years. It's got historical, cultural, and very specific business relationships that have been entrenched in the last 30, 40 years. The business relationship has really taken off in the last 5, 6 years. But we've seen on a number of occasions that we haven't really fully leveraged this business relationship between South Africa and India. And so this launch of the Africa-India Business Network is directly as a result of that, is how do we utilize this as an initiative to be able to advance and further entrench this relationship between South Africa and India at a commercial perspective?
Yeah, well, Mahendran, First Rand, one of the operations that has seen success within the Indian playing field specifically. From your experience, what's your assessment of business relations as it stands right now?
From an India-Africa perspective, Alicia, I think business relations are very positive. It's driven from the government level. We see both Minister Anand Sharma and our Minister in South Africa, Rob Davis, mm-hmm. driving a lot of aggressive targets. And I think business has taken its cue from that. We see evidence in President Zuma's recent trip to India. A staggering amount of corporates from South Africa went across, and the engagement is one that continues. We as First Rand have seen that queue, and we position ourselves as a bank in that corridor to drive these deal flows that we see going through into the future.
Well, we'll be getting into what exactly you're doing in India in just a bit. But Shambhu, I mean, the last I checked, bilateral trade between South Africa and India set to grow to, what, $10 billion by 2012. It had been labeled a modest target when it had been set in the first place. But important here is that we have businesses like First Rand within the financial space looking to tap into this opportunity. What are some of the sectors that are standing right now as strong draw cards?
Well, you know, the relationships spread across a variety of sectors, but I think in terms of standout sectors, one would have to identify perhaps mining, coal, automobiles, pharmaceuticals, for the financial sector. I mean, there really is a very broad-based engagement. Mm-hmm. Unfair to maybe single out one sector as doing well, but essentially what we're seeing is a rediscovery of India by South African companies and Indian companies engaging far more strongly with South Africa than they have ever in the past. Yeah. We have very exciting news on the corporate front.
Well, we've been made all too aware of the opportunities that present itself on that side, but more importantly, I guess, is the challenges US business still face on that, and what are some of the hurdles to doing business in India?
I think first and foremost, some of the big hurdles are in India, as much as there's an opportunity, there are challenges, as with any other market. There are certain sectors which have a very high regulatory regime, mm-hmm. and it's important for companies to try and navigate through that regime. Secondly, I think infrastructure is a problem. We see some companies who have manufacturing bases in India having to move product between state to state in India, and that presents its own sets of challenges. So you've got to understand regional dynamics in India. That's also an important challenge which clients need to overcome. Mm-hmm. Also needing to understand the landscape of employing talent in India. As much as India is a country that has talent in abundance, there are certain sectors where talent's hard to come by. So those are some of the high-level challenges that we see clients having to navigate through.
But also being made mention of is the fact that when it comes to red tape specifically, the Indian government is reforming inducing reforms specifically within the financial arena. What are you making of the strides being made in that regard specifically?
For sure. We're seeing a lot of liberalization in the financial sector. Recently, there's drafts being made in terms of the banking landscape in India, whereby the government is mooting a paper where foreign banks could become subsidiaries in India. And this will allow for greater parity between foreign banks and domestic banks in India in terms of getting greater access to branches, etc. So those are very positive moves, and it's for those reasons that we've positioned ourselves as a bank in India.
Well, Abdullah, I mean, we're looking at a very different business or trade relationship here compared to the one South Africa has with China, for example. I mean, here it's private business that's driving the investment case more so than the state itself. Are we seeing just as much interest coming through from India into South Africa?
I think we see a significant interest from India into South Africa. There are now about 96 Indian companies doing business here in South Africa, many of whom have become household names. This week we'll see Tata launching an automotive factory here in South Africa. And many of these companies, as you rightly so, the majority of them are private sector companies. The state in India provides the enabling environment to be able to assist Indian companies to deepen their engagement with South Africa, but largely driven by diversified family-owned companies from India coming and doing business here in South Africa. I think what's very interesting, and this is the analysis that we found, is that we've seen the initial forerunners that came and invested here in South Africa, Ranbaxy, Tata, and the Tata group of companies invested in various sectors in South Africa. But what's happened post this financial crisis since 2008, 2009, is we've seen the second wave of Indian investment coming into Africa, and specifically South Africa being used as a launch pad and a gateway for operations into the rest of Africa. And so you'll see a number of new Indian companies starting to operate now in South Africa, what we now call, as I said, the second wave of Indian investment coming into the continent. And that's very interesting, because I think that will really drive the bilateral trade relationship between South Africa and India.
In your opinion, Shambo, is it more beneficial for business, you know, where state plays a stronger hand, or should state remain as just a provider of an efficient regulatory system?
Well, no, that in India we've had a combination of public and private sector driving the economy, so I don't think there's any reason to rule out either part of the scenario from being active in South Africa. For example, we just recently had the Indian state trading company called the MMTC, which is a very large entity in terms of trade, and they have opened a full office in Johannesburg, which is the first office they've opened in South in Africa as a whole. And you know, the Indian state-owned companies are also very large players in the Indian economy, and I think they're also going to come into Africa, into South Africa, in a bigger way to engage. So I think we'll see a continuing dominance of the private sector, because that's something that those are the first movers in the sense. State-owned companies have been a little slow to come into Africa, but they're also coming in a big way.
Well, Abdullah, you touched on the fact that, you know, it's the African story that these companies would be buying into more so than anything else moving forward. And a lot of that would hinge on our ability to move through and forward with African integration. Is that happening enough?
I think this has been advanced on a number of fronts. Is how do we actually leverage this relationship with the BRIC economies? As we stand today, we've got 1.3 billion Chinese individuals, 1.1 billion Indian individuals, and then 1 billion Africans that sit on this continent. That's 57% of the world's population, either Chinese, Indian, or African. How do we take advantage? How do we leverage this intra-emerging market flows that are starting to fall through from China coming into Africa, from India coming into Africa? Mm-hmm. And I think the fundamental issue, recently we had a massive summit that took place, the India-Africa Summit, and a number of decisions were taken at the India-Africa Summit in terms of how do we position this continent, how do we leverage SADC or COMESA or ECOWAS in terms of regional integration. I think that fundamentally will be the key determinant in terms of how Africa will be able to leverage the relationship with some of these BRIC economies.
Well, gentlemen, we've run out of time, so we're going to have to leave it there for this morning. Thanks so much for having joined me at the desk. Of course, Abdullah Barachia is director of the India-Africa Business Network, Mahendran Mudli, CEO of First Rand India, and Shambu Kumaran, the Deputy High Commissioner of India as well.